Hello, B-Town. So, as I said, I've been saying for maybe a month and a half now, I'm going to meet with each candidate who's running. We have five great people running this year. So we have some choices, and I think it's a really great idea to put them in touch with our community and the people who live here. Maybe you don't know some of them. You know, maybe you never met them. Maybe you want to know where they stand on the issues. So that's what I'm here for. I narrowed it down to like 20 questions or so. A lot of you submitted. So we're going to get right into it. Everyone, this is Joe Myers. So Joe, introduce yourself. Tell us a little about yourself and your background, first of all, before we get into the questions.
Thank you. Good evening, Brennan, and thank you for the opportunity. My name is Joe Myers. My wife and I, Lauren, live on Reeder Avenue in town. We have two kids, 12-year-old son Gus and 15-year-old daughter Caitlin. We moved to the city in 2005, and we've been here ever since. We just fell in love with the city. We have family here, but we loved it for all the same reasons everyone else does, with the schools, the parks, the walkability, and of course the restaurants.
It is, once you come visit once, you don't want to leave.
You're hooked.
You know, you're hooked. I call it the Hoover vacuum of New Jersey. You get sucked in. And tell us a little about your background, education, you know, what have you done, what jobs,
sure.
You know, a little about that.
So I graduated, I still call it Trenton State. So I graduated from Trenton State in 1998 with a major in political science, went to grad school at the University of Pennsylvania and got two master's degrees there. And then I moved and lived in Camden City, and also had my first job there, and I've been there ever since. Started as an intern for an organization called Cooper's Ferry. It's a private nonprofit that does community economic development.
Oh, that's nice.
And I have been there ever since. I'm now the chief operating officer. I oversee 12 colleagues in the office, and we're focused on rebuilding the city of Camden.
Okay, so you know you have a good background in this that kind of led you to what you're doing now and why you want to run, which is actually my first question. What made you want to run?
It's a good question. I would say that it goes back to when I was growing up, my parents were very involved and volunteered in town and kind of set the model that, you know, whatever you do in life, you have to give back. So Lauren and I have kind of tried to instill that in our kids. And I think kind of the community service, the volunteering is something that I've strived to make our kids think about and get involved with. And so that was the main reason I ran 4 years ago, and it's the reason I'm running for re-election now. I think that it's just, I currently serve on the board at the Salvation Army and their Croc Center, and I'm a huge sports fan. So I've been a volunteer basketball coach all over Burlington County, CYO, travel.
Oh, nice.
For over 20 years and babble selfishly coaching my kids for the past 8 or so years.
I coach soccer. I know how that can be. It's fun, but you know what? I had a problem with the parents sometimes, so, you know. Now, how do you view your role as a public servant?
So I would say that the role of a public servant is, I look at it that it's about kind of, it's about working together with people, and it's a privilege. Let me just say that first. So public service is a privilege. It's a privilege because what you need to do is you need to listen to people. You need to be able to work together with people, unite people, and talk to people of different opinions. I think kind of disagreement's a good thing. And I think as part of that, then you need to be able to bring people together to bring some sort of change. And I think if you look at kind of, I look at this past 4 years, as, or tonight at least, as a job interview. Mm-hmm. It's a job interview to kind of look at, you know, what have you done at Public Works and what have done at the Water Department. And I think that kind of the projects we've been able to complete or the things we've been able to do together, certainly, I mean, hopefully the one takeaway about this tonight is that it's a team environment. It's a team of Public Works and City Hall and the Water Department. But at the end of the day, it's an opportunity that I feel I'm extremely appreciative of, but it's one that I feel as though that you have to earn it. You have to earn people's confidence and show people that you can make a difference.
It's true. I like that you said it's like a privilege, you know? Not everybody can do it. I know I couldn't do it. Now, we'll get into some tougher questions. With such a tough, unprecedented last year, how do you think our city did with dealing with the pandemic?
So, good question. I would say a few different answers. First, I would say that kind of if you look at it from what the city as a team did, so the mayor, the deputy mayor, myself, I think that we launched a grant program for our small businesses because we knew that they're the lifeline of our community. And it certainly wasn't, it was Mayor Lynch's idea, and he should get 110% of the credit. And then Deputy Mayor Badowski working in the finance department. And I think kind of all of us worked together to kind of create a program from scratch, which was very difficult. But again, it's something that we felt strongly about, that we had to kind of give back to the local businesses. And I was very fortunate that an old neighbor of mine, you're joking, when I lived on throughout the city, when I lived on Prince Street, one of my old neighbors approached me, and she works for an organization, and it was a very philanthropic organization, and wanted to give back too. So we were able to kind of leverage philanthropic dollars that she had allocated through the foundation she works with, in addition to the city funds, and help out our business community.
I thought that was great. I mean, you know, I work at the Hob, so I work locally in town. And when I heard about that, I thought that was a really awesome thing you all did.
It was a team effort. And I think kind of, and then selfishly with Public Works, I think kind of the pandemic was the challenge for Public Works, honestly, because what we looked at in the very beginning, and I say we, it was John Walls and Bob Erickson, that we wanted to kind of put a value on our employees. So what we did was actually something that not many other towns did, is we actually took the entire staff of Public Works, divided them in half, and put them on split shifts. Meaning that it's really hard to social distance at Public Works down at the yard. And if one person got sick, then it would wipe out everyone, and we wouldn't be able to do anything.
Wow, that's a good thing. I never thought of that. I didn't know you guys did that.
So the challenge, or the balance of that, is that so we basically had half people working every week and rotated them. So I say the challenge with that is because you had to focus on your core business and core municipal services. I know there's a question eventually in here, maybe about parks, and I think there was a lot of things I wish we could have done more, but the challenge is at the end of the day, we chose to kind of ensure the health and safety of the employees, but then do is, you know, kind of the core services.
You had to. I mean, anything, it was a tough year. Like I said, it was unprecedented, so there was no book to follow. There was no rules to follow. It was kind of like everybody was winging it. And, you know, like I said, you weren't going to make everybody happy, but everybody pretty much stayed safe. So I think it was a win-win.
Great analogy. You know? And I think the one thing is, it's communication. I think the one thing that when you're sitting on the one side of Carr's Lake and you're at these commissioner meetings is that we have a ton of information. And I will give Mayor Lynch a ton of credit, because every day he was sending us multiple emails and text messages about kind of all the information he was getting, just because he was head of the police and head of public affairs and the mayor. So we were getting info from the county health department and from the state of New Jersey. And I think part of our job is just sharing that with others.
Thank you. All right. Actually, I'm going to skip to this other question because you brought up communication. Where is it? Sorry, guys. And it's about... Oh, darn it.
If you want, I can. So you asked a few questions about being present and about engaging and communicating.
Yes. How do you plan on communicating with the residents and reaching them? Because, and also a follow-up to that, a lot of people on Facebook and Instagram have been asking the city for more of a social media presence and maybe getting us information through social media. Is that a possibility also?
So there's a lot to unpack there. So let me try and go in reverse.
Okay.
So I think being present and being accountable is something that I truly believe is one of the most fundamental things for being an elected official. As I said, just because of the volume of information we have, but also that, you know, in my mind, with an elected official, part of our responsibility is, you know, maybe 15 years ago, people would go to Carr's Lake and that's how they heard about what's going on in government. But as you and I were joking, that like right now, this is where you get your information.
It is.
So I think you need to be able to adapt to that. So a commissioner has to be able to adapt to that. So let me just elaborate on that if I can. Mm-hmm. So I think in Public Works, we interact with every person every day. We interact with, whether you're at the Hob and you're turning on the water spigot, or if we're picking up trash, clearing snow, we're filling potholes, we're doing all the regular municipal services. If you're walking to your kids to school, or if you're walking to the restaurants in downtown, you've interacted with Public Works multiple times. So how do we convey that information on what we're doing? So I think one of the unique things that we did at Public Works was, we, unlike any other administration, we opted to kind of, when we're looking to rebuild roads and rebuild utilities, before we even started construction or design, we decided to have community meetings. And I think that was the first time I met you actually in here with West Street Park.
Yes.
So I think the idea is that we wanted to engage residents first and ask them what they wanted to see on their streets. And whether it was filling the potholes or new sidewalks and making them accessible or connecting them, I think I didn't want to assume that I knew that information. So the first thing we did is we went and engaged residents. So that informed then when we started the design and the engineering, so that the engineer wasn't just designing something that could be designed anywhere. They know that well, if I live on Burlington Street, I know that that's a highly trafficked for kids walking to school, so we have to make sure that the crosswalks are oriented to making sure that they're safe. So I think that's the first thing with communication. The second thing is I would look at it and say that I'm not the best person with social media, but I think it's about being responsive. So as I was literally sitting over here waiting for you, somebody messaged me about curbs on Thompson Street. Somebody then stopped me a few minutes later and asked about some of the striping we're doing at 2nd and Cortland. I think all of that is just being responsive to people, responding to stuff on Facebook. And I think the last time I stopped counting was that I had posted my cell phone over 80 times on the city's unofficial web or on Facebook. And I think part of that is just making sure that you're accessible, knowing people know that you're there. And I think part of that, then the last thing I would say about just being present and communicating is, this is the first time in my understanding is that this was ever done, is I made sure that every month that I had a monthly report of what was going on at Public Works and Water. And again, we have so much that's going on that I handed that info out, but then I also worked with you and others to make sure it was posted on Facebook, because that's where people are getting information. And especially in a pandemic, people may not feel comfortable coming to Cars Lake, so it's my job to adapt and make sure that they can get that information.
I was going to say, I admin the city page, and you post there a lot. So I do appreciate that, because I find out a lot of stuff from your posts. And I've shared them to my page, too. So I really appreciate that about you. I always say you have good transparency that way. And another thing, I didn't know you were specifically Public Works, so thank you for such a good job with all the snow plowing this winter. That was rough.
I would say we were lucky in the first few years of my 4-year term that there wasn't a lot of snow, but this past time it was a lot of snow. But I mean, credit goes to Bob Erickson, because he's literally developing staffing schedules and making sure that people show up and working overtime. And again, I think that it's a team. It's a team environment. But thank you.
Okay. Oh, that was my other question. Okay. Do you think our downtown is healthy and successful? What changes would you like to see?
So, good question. I'm going to answer that and then also fold it into another one of the questions you just had about parking.
Okay.
I know that at the end of the day, I think that's one of the greatest strengths in Bordentown is the downtown and the restaurants. And credit goes to CJ and the DBA, because they do an amazing job. I would say that kind of 4 years ago when I started, a big issue people had was parking.
Yes.
And I think that's a challenge. It was a challenge 4 years ago, and it's a challenge today. I think the one thing that I've learned over 4 years that there is no one answer to solve the parking problem in the city. What I would say is that what we've been able to do is kind of be a little bit creative. So working at Public Works, we've been able to rebuild two city parking lots, the one right behind OTP or adjacent to it, and the one off of East Church Street. And we're not adding much inventory, but I believe that part of it is just, it's incremental progress. It's adding a few spaces here, a few spaces there, working with the DBA to also make sure that we have the shuttle services running. And I know that's been successful. And then I also believe at the last month's Public Works meeting, we talked about how the city secured an electronic vehicle charging station.
Yeah, I saw that.
So I think we're going to be working on that in the next few months, or if I have the opportunity to come post-May, that'll be something that we'll work in. But at the end of the day, I think that's one of the best things about the city is the downtown and the businesses. And that's when there was pre-COVID, that's when everyone would come to the street fair and Cranberry Festival, and that's what drew people into town and had them kind of see what was here.
I think it also drew a lot of people to move here. You know, once you come to a street fair, come out to eat and walk around town, just the places I've lived and sitting outside, you know, there I always hear like, oh, what a charming little town. So, you know, it introduces a lot of people
Absolutely. To
Bordentown City. Okay. How do you feel zoning and planning impact our city? Do you think stricter guidelines and enforcement should be in place? And also, do you think we can communicate with the township and other surrounding communities on issues that affect us?
So great question, and I want to say full confession that wasn't a question I planted, but I think that's a great question, because kind of three questions you asked there. The first was that I think the planning board and the planning experts have done a great job in the city in the past few years, and I think the testament to that is the work that they did kind of when they formed a resident advisory committee to look at the former Ocean Spray property. The planning board engaged residents to make sure that they were part of the process and kind of creating that vision for the future reuse of that. So I think there was a tremendous amount of credit goes to the planning board for that. That's one. And then two, over the past year, I know that our office, Public Works, has worked with the Environmental Commission and the Planning Board over adopting new standards for stormwater regulations. So there's a huge push at the state level to have municipalities look at its stormwater, and we work collaboratively with those agencies to do that. I think the other thing I would say is, kind of in after the first few years at Public Works and the Water Department, I realized that one of the disconnects we had was kind of coordination with the township. So while people think that, well, the township really doesn't affect the city because the warehouses or the truck traffic is out, you know, past the city's limits, the reality is that that's actually not true. So all of that development that's going on directly affects the city because the city supplies the water in the township.
Oh, I never knew that.
So
okay.
One of the things that we instituted was we now have monthly coordination meetings with the township and their development team so that we can start planning the expansion of the water department and make sure that we
know
that
great.
When we build out our infrastructure, we can make sure that we're coordinating with them so that we know that we're not going to be behind anything. We know that if the one area of the township is where they're going to be building out their warehouse district or whatever the zoning is, then we make sure that our infrastructure is built out to accommodate that.
Oh, that's great. I didn't know that. I'm glad we're having this talk. Okay, now here's another resident question. As someone who has seen this before, how do we address the process of gentrification, pushing out families who have been in our town for generations? Shouldn't our workers be able to live in the same town they serve?
So that's a great question. So it's a complicated issue with gentrification. And I would say that, kind of in no particular order, I think one of the assets and benefits the city has is that as we were just talking about, it's a great community where people want to live. Right, mm-hmm. And they want to raise a family. So I think because of that strength, we have great schools, we have great kind of restaurants and parks, and people want to live here. So I think from my perspective, what a commissioner should be doing is making sure then that the people that work for Public Works or the Water Department have a living wage and can afford to stay here, because ultimately that's the incentive, is that you're giving and offering them a living wage for the work that they do so that they can afford to stay here.
That's a great answer. And then another resident question. I know New York City-based buyers who were interested in Bordentown. They thought the taxes were too high to be justified by the average school ratings. Why haven't our high taxes led to a better school system as per standardized markers?
So in full disclosure, let me say that my wife and I are huge public school advocates. I don't want to say, obviously, we were talking earlier about my kids. My kids are in the public school system. So I think that Bordentown has a great school district. I think, kind of just to sidetrack for 1 second, the teachers should be getting a tremendous amount of credit. Just having a child in the middle school and one in the high school, we hear every day about how the teachers are challenged, right, on many different levels. And I just want to say unequivocally that they're doing an amazing job. I think that, kind of, as we talked about, there's no playbook for this. Now imagine a teacher having to teach in a virtual world and then in person and then a hybrid, and it's a lot. So I would say that the utmost respect for teachers. I would say, though, that I disagree a little bit with the question, because, in my opinion, that the merit ranking is a little bit, it's antiquated. And let me explain it if I may.
Yeah, please.
So from my understanding of it, the merit system or the ranking is predicated that it places more value on students that are going away to a four-year school.
Okay.
And I would say that 15, 20 years ago, when I was in high school, it's something, and that was the barometer that a lot of people did. But I would say in today's day and age, that the cost of colleges, the cost of higher education is something that a lot of people can't afford, and that's not a bad thing. So when students that are graduating from the high school want to go to a vocational school or to a tech school, or even say that I can't afford to go away to a four-year school, so I'm going to go to a county college for a few years and then go, I think that's a good thing. Right? So it's about affordability, but that metric system actually would penalize Bordentown for doing that.
Okay.
So I would say that kind of it should be reevaluated to look at that and say that, you know, colleges aren't for every child, and that's okay.
That's a great answer. Because there's so many, we have so many blue collar workers in town too. So, you know, it's, I never knew that until you explained that to me, what that system was based on. So that's a really great answer. Thank you. I'm enjoying our talk, Joe.
Thank you.
How would you rate the maintenance and care of our open spaces and parks? What improvements or changes would you like to see happen?
So I would say two or three comments. The first, I would say that the city has great park systems, great trails, mm-hmm. great kind of accessibility, and just by its sheer access, it's got so much to offer in terms of outdoor space. I would say objectively, though, and this is a criticism of my department, that I think we could have done a lot more. I think that at Public Works, like, I think that, you know, that the challenge is that you have a limited resources and how you deploy those. And unfortunately, the pandemic actually was a kind of a perfect storm because, as I was mentioning earlier, we had these split work schedules.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, then we didn't have the time to put to the maintenance. So I would say, again, I think part of this is a job interview. You have to realize, like, what are things you can improve upon? And I think that's absolutely something in Public Works that we can improve upon. I would say that the thing that I'm excited about is kind of a model that we adopted at the Water Department a few years ago. And we've adopted that, and it's only been like less than a month or month and a half that we're doing on the parks side. So the mayor, the deputy mayor, and I recently announced a parks commission. And with this parks committee, what we're doing is the model at the Water Department was that we created a resident advisory group and had them inform us at the Water Department of assessing the assets at the Water Department and then putting a 10-year capital plan. So that kind of inclusive approach we're modeling at the Parks Department, I mean, to be unfolded in the next few months. But the idea is, like, right now we don't have an inventory of our Parks Department. We don't have an assessment on it. And so right now the squeaky wheel gets the resources, and I feel as though that's not good government. What we should have is, sorry. Okay. What we should have is a 10-year capital plan that assesses all the parks in the city and say that, okay, this is the condition of the existing assets we have, and then create a corresponding 10-year investment plan so we know that each year this is where the parks are going to be investing its resources. We know that it's going to go to playground equipment, or it's going to go to improving the basketball courts and things like that, because I want it to kind of be out of my hands. I want it to be something that's actually a document that professionals have looked at and they've coordinated with residents and residents that use these parks and open spaces.
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I think kind of the big picture thing would just be a divine word. And I think the open space out there is kind of the partners we have with DNR Greenway and the state of New Jersey. I think that's going to be a truly tremendous gem for the city in the next few years.
You know, my friends and I were talking yesterday. I know I've noticed we have gotten a lot of grants these past couple years, too. I don't know if that was you or it's team effort, but, you know, a lot of money going to the parks, too.
Absolutely. And a team effort, as you said. Mm-hmm. So I think the benefit of that is that what we've been able to do is write a significant number of grants. So we've been fortunate that we write grants to improve our road system, our parks department, and I think all of that is, we have a lot of that teed up, and I think the point is, that's all the more reason why I wanted to have this parks committee kind of put together and populated with residents so that we can help inform that decision so that they know that it's just not, well, we're not just rebuilding this park. There's actually somebody that looked at this and evaluated and said, okay, the parks, these playgrounds, for instance, the playground equipment at Carr's Lake we know is antiquated and we have to improve in the next 12 months. So I think we've been going after grants, not with the playground, but those are dollars that we've allocated. And another example of that is that's the building right behind us at Carr's Lake. We know that, I mean, if anyone that's been in there for a Babel game, and I've been there a lot,
mm-hmm.
You know that it's got antiquated building systems, it's got the scoreboard mm-hmm. was broken, it's been, you know, it had issues, the floor is needs to be redone. So I think that I look at kind of the job at Public Works is that we've got to get as much grant funding as we can to make sure that we improve our roads, our parks, and our community centers.
How do we make our town more marketable?
So I would say that the marketability of the town is, it's like a hidden gem in the city. And mm-hmm. I think one of the things that I would suggest is kind of more special events, more collaborations with like Bordentown Traditions, with the DBA, because at the end of the day, that's one of the prime drivers is people coming in for our downtown and to our restaurants. But then the special events are where you get, as you were just saying earlier, your friends and others to come in here and say, wow, you know, there's so much going on here. I didn't even know about this, or I didn't even know about the restaurants. So I think part of it is just more of inclusive conversations. But I would absolutely unequivocally say the DBA does a great job of the downtown. I think the DBA is one of the great kind of partners we have at the city level.
We talked about parking. We already did. We skipped over that. But I'm glad that you addressed that. How will the issue of unrepaired, damaged sidewalks, especially on the side streets, be addressed? Crosswalks, intersection safety as well. I know we kind of just talked about that, you know.
Sure, but it's a good question. So I know there's a few questions that talked about kind of sidewalks. So if I'm just going to lump them all together,
yeah.
That's okay. So I think the past 4 years, Public Works has been very, very fortunate to, as I said, secure grants, but we've rebuilt about a little bit over 10 or 11% of the city's roadways. And as part of that, then, I think the process of that is just ensuring that there's a connectivity, that there's accessibility. So when I first was voted into office, it was interesting. I had former mayor, or I call him Citizen Malone, and Ziggy, told me that, you know, the worst sidewalk in the city is in front of Consolidated. It's
oh,
a gateway in the
yeah.
city. So I think kind of one of the first things that we looked at Public Works was, okay, if that's the one of the front doors to our downtown, we need to improve that. So we were able to improve that sidewalk. And I think that's, it's a cosmetic thing, but it's extremely important. I think when you go back to those projects I mentioned when we were rebuilding, 2nd Street, West Street, Burlington, Willow, and soon to be Oliver, I think one of the things that we've looked at is improving sidewalks. And I would suggest that as part of all of those projects, and it's been over $1 million of grant funding the city's been fortunate to secure, we've improved those sidewalks. We've actually, I think the number I had was over 50 crosswalks that we improved.
Oh, wow.
And made sure they're ADA compliant. And as part of that, I think it's also making sure that we've added sidewalks where sidewalks don't exist. Like, I know part of our project a few years ago on 2nd Street was rebuilding the road, and there was a section that we worked on at the end of, kind of right at the corner of Bank and 2nd. And kind of that's where we're able to leverage the grant dollars we get with the sidewalk program that the city has on an annual basis. So I think sidewalks, again, being objective, mm-hmm. it's a very, very old city. I read that it was incorporated over 340 some years mm-hmm. ago. So it's got old infrastructure and old sidewalks. But I think what we've been able to do is systematically start improving them road by road.
One resident asked about the status of the Spring Street Ballpark and another field being built for kids. Is that still in the works?
Yeah, so it's a little complicated. So if I can just give a little bit of context.
Sure, sure, sure.
So from what I'm told, the city acquired the Ann Street Ball Field about 10 or 12 years ago from Ocean Spray. And unfortunately, when the city acquired it, it didn't do any due diligence, meaning that it didn't do any environmental investigations. So the city has a grant currently in hand from the county to rebuild the Ann Street ball fields. As we were doing our due diligence for the park rehab, we found out that there was some contaminations of some arson levels.
Uh-huh.
So what happened was we had to pause the actual ball field improvements and we had to do some investigations. And unfortunately, the contamination was more severe than we thought. So what we ended up doing was doing a lot of outreach to residents and making sure that the backyards of those properties that butt up against those, we're investigating those parcels. So where we are today is, unfortunately, we are incurred some significant costs just to do that remediation. We're in the process of getting a grant from the state to reimburse the city for portions of that, which is
oh,
good.
That's great.
But it certainly sidetracked the ability to build that one ball field. So what I would say is that the investigation of that environmental or of that arson issue is something that's underway. They call it in the engineering world the remediation or the cleanup of that. Something that will happen this calendar year. So the hope is that, kind of, I'd say construction on the ball fields will start, say, the beginning. I mean, hopefully, again, if I'm given the opportunity, mm-hmm. then I would suggest then the actual remediation and would follow, and then the actual ball field itself would start construction next late winter, early spring.
Oh, okay. So that's not too far away. Do you feel it's important to have a presence in the community at events, vigils, etc., and why?
So I would say it all goes back to that original question about just being present and accountability. So the short answer is yes. I think kind of having an official be present at, you know, whether it's a vigil, whether it's marches, I think showing up and showing the community that you're willing to listen, but then also support them, but then also kind of take that back and actually effectuate some change. So I think all of that is extremely, extremely important. And if I could segue into another question.
Sure,
sure. I feel very passionate about this topic, so that's why I'm kind mm-hmm. of cheating looking at your notes.
Yeah, go ahead.
So the short answer is yes, being present and being accountable is extremely, extremely important. And I think kind of along those lines, diversity. Mm-hmm. So I know that diversity is something that I know others have talked about when we submitted our candidate statements, and it's a great question about kind of just the diversity of the city commission, the diversity in the city, and how you kind of effectuate that. And I think from my perspective, I have, in my past 4 years, have kind of shown that diversity is more than just a word. I mean, I believe it's something that should be talked about openly, kind of clearly, consistently, but then also as an elected official, what you should be asking me is, well, you've talked about it, Joe, but what have you done to actually show me that that's important to you? And that's a valid question. And I would say that if you were to ask Jimmy or John when they're here, the work sessions that we had in that room right across from you, they'll tell you that when we talked about diversity, I was the first one to hammer home the conversation, to say that we as city commissioners need to make sure that in committee appointments that we're looking at, that we need to have a more reflective diversity or representation from the people that live in the city. I was the one that was telling them that we need to start doing that immediately. But then the other follow-up question you should be thinking about is, well, what have you done at Public Works to promote diversity? And that's something that I'm extremely proud of, is if you look at the workforce from where it was 4 years ago to today, the hires that we've had are more of a diverse workforce, one. Two, also the promotion of people within the city I've advocated for to make sure that there's more diversity there. So I think when you kind of look back at the past 4 years, everyone's going to tell you that they're about diversity. And I would say that you don't let them off on that. Ask them and say, well, what have you shown me in the past 4 years to show me that you've done something to actually promote that?
Good. That's okay. How important are volunteers to the city? And what can be done to support and encourage more people to volunteer?
So I would say, for anyone that's been to a city meeting, you'll hear that the city is based on volunteers, right? It's such a small city that you need volunteers to help, whether it's with all the committees it has or whatever the case is. And I think the best example of volunteering was this past Saturday. So I know you were there, but this past Saturday was the tree planting. And 100% of the credit should go to Al Barker and the Shade Tree Commission. I mean, this was a great day for him. But he would be the first one to also tell you that that day was successful because many, many other people, volunteers, whether it's folks from the Green Team, whether it's folks from the Environmental Commission, or even if it's Bob Erickson and the Public Works folks kind of prepping for those sites. But that was the perfect, from my perspective, the perfect example of why this city is great and why it's built on volunteers. And selfishly, it was a great day for me because I was able to get my 15-year-old daughter to come with me, and she was so excited to actually see firsthand that, you know, although we only dug a few holes and planted two trees, but that, to me, that was the best example of saying, like, Caitlin, you've got to practice what you preach, and if you want to get involved in your community, this is the perfect way in which you can do that.
Here's a good question. It's a different one. We're slipping into getting out of the more serious stuff. What's one of your favorite historical elements in town?
So I'll go back to this past Saturday. So I think first, the city's got obviously a great rich history, whether you're talking about BMI and kind of the rich history with the Veterans Memorial. I would also think or suggest that kind of one of the ones that's going to get a lot of attention in the next few months is Claire Barton and the importance of her as a person. And it was, I guess it was ironic or lucky that on Saturday, as my daughter and I are at the tree planting, we were fortunate to be right next to Bonnie Goldman. So anybody that knows Bonnie Goldman knows that she's just a tremendous amount of energy and extremely passionate about the Historical Society. And she was able to kind of just impart some wisdom with my daughter about who Claire Barton was and the importance of her with Red Cross and the importance of her with the school, talking about the rededication of the school, which I believe is on June 11th. And I think just having that snapshot of having my daughter Kate, hear that was just great because it's a history that, you know, you don't really know. So I think kind of the rich history of the city is extremely important, but I think Claire Barton and her kind of importance into the city was huge.
Tell us your top three priorities over the next 4 years.
So, good question. So I'll focus on Public Works because I think that's kind of the lane that I'm in. I would say that kind of the top priority, and ironically we haven't talked about it, but as I kind of cheat and look at your I'll mention water, but I'll come back to that just because I think when we talk about it as an accomplishment, that's something that I really want to focus on. But the first priority I would be was just continuing to improve and invest in the water system. I think the second would be just as we look at kind of, or if I look out at this view here, we have a baseball field, we have a playground, and we have Cars Lake. So this view that I have here just kind of runs the gamut of kind of the great community assets and recreational facilities the city has. And I think we need to improve those. We need to make sure that we're reinvesting in those. And I know that we've applied for a few $100,000 of grants to rebuild Cars Lake. We have money to rebuild the playground behind us, and we're about to replace the scoreboard down at Gilder Field. So I think kind of the second priority I would have would just be reinvesting into our parks, our roads, and our infrastructure and community centers. The last one's going to be difficult because it's a monumental task, and I don't want people to think this is just me. I just think that a huge priority the city's going to have is just the physical relocation of where City Hall is right now to Divine Word. And if I could just elaborate on it for a second.
Sure, sure.
We're talking about moving an entire police department and their station to Divine Word, in addition to moving the operations of City Hall. So just the physical logistics, put aside kind of, I'm just going to talk about the building itself. Mm-hmm. So you have to make sure that the building is designed and up to code for a police station. You have to make sure that all the buildings are ADA compliant and they have all the right kind of office infrastructure, IT infrastructure, wireless, which are things that the building doesn't have today. And then just if you look outside of the building, I would say that kind of being an infrastructure person, the roads to get in and out of Divine Word, they're not ADA compliant. There's not really any trails to get from point A to point B right now. And there's also kind of the widening of the road, I feel, that we need to do, because anyone that's been out there, that when one car's driving in, you can't have another car coming the other direction. So I would say if it's me if it's anybody else that takes over Public Works this upcoming election, that kind of the relocation of Divine Word is going to be a huge undertaking.
And my last question, what was one thing you were proud of over the past 4 years that you accomplished that you can tell us?
So the water department, I think that was something that was, it was a big issue 4 years ago when I came into office. And for those that are unaware, the city was cited by the state for having an exceedance of lead in its water. Mm-hmm. And it was a complex problem. And I would like to give credit to a lot of different people. One, I would say, would be Pat Ryan, and the other one was Joe Malone, because they said from day one, you've got to surround yourself with smart people, because it's not an issue it's not something one person can resolve. So we put together a resident advisory group, and we brought together people that are a lot smarter than me, whether it was John Walls at the water department or in consultation with people to the state. But we created a plan on how we'd be able to use science and use data and offer people free testing. And we continually asserted that the problem wasn't with the water itself. It wasn't the problem with the source. It wasn't the problem with lead lines, which is unfortunately common in cities like Trenton and Newark. The problem was an interior plumbing problem, or an interior plumbing problem inside people's homes. But the hard part is we had to prove that. So we had to collect not tens and twenties, but I'm talking about thousands of samples of water in order to show people the data. And I look back at it now and I'm extremely proud of it, because clean, safe water is one of the most fundamental things a government should be offering its residents. And I'm glad that we were able to create a resident advisory group that was able to help communicate that message and help formulate the city through that time, because it was a very complex problem and it's a very scientific problem. And I look back at it now and I'm happy, because that model, that inclusive kind of a collaborative approach with residents and professionals, is what I'm looking to replicate at the Parks Department.
Okay. And Joe, I want to thank you so much for sitting down with me today. I had a really good time, and I really learned a lot, and I'm really glad we talked. Now, is there anything you'd like to say to the residents of Bordentown City? Any messages?
First, thank you for the opportunity, Brenna. I appreciate the conversation and I appreciate the opportunity, because I know this is taking out of your personal time. So I know I just appreciate that. I said this in the beginning. I just want to kind of conclude with it, that at the end of the day, without hesitation, I would say that the men and women that work inside City Hall and the Water Department and the Public Works are exceptional people, because they're the ones that they're there at City Hall or Public Works every day, rain or shine, in a global pandemic or not. Those are the ones that are doing the work, and I wouldn't be here without them. So I just want to show my appreciation and thank them publicly. I would like to think I've thanked them a lot, but I value their opinion. I respect their contributions, and I think that's a testament about leadership, right? A testament of somebody's leadership traits are how they treat the people around them. And I think if you were to ask any one of them, they would say that I'm somebody that they feel that they're respected and they're a meaningful contributor, because at the end of the day, it's a team. It's not one person. It's really a team environment. So thank you.
All right. Thank you so much, Joe. And I hope you have a great night. And I wish you good luck in the election.
Thank you.
I really had a great time today with this chat, and I really did learn a lot. So Bordentown, I hope you watch this whole vid. I'll be posting one a day. So Joe will be first. And make sure you get out there and vote. Wait, one more thing to ask you. One more thing I forgot to ask you.
Yes.
Tell people the day of the election.
Yes.
That's the most, how could we forget that?
Please vote on May 11th.
May 11th.
Thank you.
Oh, and you can come in person, Cars Lake.
Yes.
And you can also, if you opted for mail-in,
correct.
I think, right?
Yes.
Okay. How could we forget? How could we forget to tell you all the day to vote? So May 11th, everybody. Come on out and vote. All right? Have a good day, Bordentown.